Hey guys, and welcome to Zig Wheels. I'm Tushar, that's Arun, and this, well, it's Toyota's answer to the Honda City and the Hyundai Verna. It's called the Toyota Yaris.
Now, all three cars that we've got here are the petrol automatics, and we're answering one simple question. Does the Yaris have enough to lure you away from these two established stalwarts and do something more to create a niche of its own?
And since we are comparing the petrol automatics, I think it's fair to say that most of the people may be spending a lot of time in the driver's seat. So why don't we start there first?
Let's do that.
All right, let's kick things off with the Honda City. Now, this is the oldest car in this competition, but even so, it packs in a heavy punch. As we found out in our 0 to 100 km/h tests, it was the quickest, which is a good thing. What isn't good are the levels of refinement. Yes, Ivy Tech is a name that has been synonymous with refinement, but it's kind of raining on its past laurels at this point, because in this competition, it just doesn't feel as smooth and refined as it should be. That aside, this is a CVT gearbox. Yes, it does add that all-important dose of convenience, but even so, it just tends to feel a bit confused. So under path throttle inputs, whether you're going at 30 to 60 in the city or 90 to 100 km/h on the highway, it just tends to gain and lose revs pretty easily, which does take its toll on fuel efficiency, because in the city was the least fuel efficient. And that is an important point to consider if you are looking at the Honda City automatic as a daily drive.
Now, the Verna here employs an old-school torque converter automatic gearbox. But even then, it managed to better the efficiency of the city, inside the city, albeit by a small margin. Now, we'd call it neck and neck, but bear in mind that the Verna does have a tendency to guzzle fuel when driven in heavy bumper-to-bumper traffic. That aside, what really surprised us is the sheer refinement of this 1.6-liter engine. It's smooth, it's quiet, and only if you mash the throttle hard will you hear this engine inside the cabin. Speaking of the gearbox, it's tuned perfectly well for use inside the city. It knows when to shift up, it knows when to hold on to the gears, and it just provides a smooth, hassle-free driving experience. So there are no unpleasant surprises here.
But what did come as a pleasant surprise, and quite a shocking one at that, is the Yaris's CVT. Yes, in essence, it's the same technology that you see in the Honda City, but it just feels like a more evolved and Gen Next version of the CVT, which means you're getting a more direct relationship between throttle inputs and gear changes. It feels so much more intuitive, and it all comes together to give you a more calming, a more relaxing, and more easy to drive experience. And not only does that make things better in terms of convenience, it also eggs you on to drive more fuel efficiently. And when you do that, it rewards you in spades. Speaking specifically about city fuel efficiency, this was the most fuel efficient car in city conditions. And that isn't the only reason why we'd pick this as our daily drive.
In our last Hyundai Verna versus Honda City comparison, we were plenty impressed by the Verna's ride quality. Yet somehow, the Yaris manages to better that, and how. No matter the road condition or speed, the Yaris feels stable, comfortable, and calming. There's barely any side-to-side or vertical movement, even over high-speed undulations with four people and luggage on board. The smaller wheels and larger tire sidewalls then do come in handy.
The Verna's ride is no longer boat-like and is properly comfortable itself. It's only the really rough patches that'll see you rocking side to side, and sharp edges will send the occasional judder into the cabin. But over most roads, it is hard to fall.
It's the Honda City that remains the black sheep in this company. The ride is noticeably stiffer than the other two, and the suspension is quite noisy over bad roads as well. If there's a rough patch ahead, be assured you will feel it rattle the cabin generously. Not uncomfortable, but it can't hold a stone to the other two.
Boil it down to handling and the picking order flips. The city feels eager through the corners thanks to the sharper steering, with the Verna following closely in second. Stable as the Yaris's suspension is, the steering is woefully vague, and even long curves on a highway will warrant corrective inputs. But then again, none of these are designed to be driver's cars. So let's put that in the back seat. Rather, let's go there ourselves.
Now, while the Honda City may not be the best pick when it comes to ride comfort, Where it redeems itself is, well, space, and it delivers that in spades. The front driver's seat is set to my driving position. I'm 6.5 feet tall, and as you can see, I can fit in here pretty comfortably. I've got good knee room, I've got good foot room, and yes, this is the cabin, or rather the only cabin, that can seat three people at the rear, because the actual shoulder room is the widest. It's simply impossible to do that in either the Verna or the Yaris. And apart from the actual space, you also have the sense of space thanks to this color choice. So it all just kind of comes together, the actual space, the sense of space, and those few features that add a little bit of novelty, like these all LED interior lights, or that soft feel element on the dashboard, or even that touch panel AC. It's not the most functional feature, it is novelty, but hey, a little novelty never killed anyone. So it all just comes together to make the cabin feel a little special, keep Sage-ji happy, and make it just feel that little bit fancy.
Now the city feels fancy, the Yaris definitely feels fancier on the inside. For instance, there are these little details that Toyota have done that just uplift the opulence inside the Yaris's cabin. For instance, the leather they've used for the upholstery, it does not have a wrinkly finish. It's nice and smooth. In fact, the same material is also used on the armrest on the doors. And then there's that 4.2 inch TFT screen in the instrument cluster that acts as the MID. It is just so much better to look at and use when you're driving. Granted, it's got nowhere as much space as the Honda City. In fact, we'll go out on a limb and say that this car is a four-seater. It's not a five-seater, because when you look at the rear bench, the central armrest protrudes, so the middle occupant won't be all that comfortable. And this armrest, that eats into the knee room as well. So yeah, it's not a comfortable place for three passengers at all. Now, let's take a look at how the Verna does. Now, we're in the back seat of the Hyundai Verna, and as you can see, space isn't really a strong point. Now, the driver's seat is set to my driving position. Tushar's height for reference is 6'5", and he doesn't have a mother-in-law. But yeah, knee room is virtually non-existent for him, and his head is now a part of the roof. But space aside, we can't really fault the Verna's cabin, can we?
Not really, because like we've come to expect from Hyundai, the cabin quality, the consistency in fit and finish, it's on point. The layout, it's sensible, it is ergonomic, it's not even an eyesore, it's not going to be polarizing in the slightest. What I would fault it for though is just that it's a bit too familiar at this point. You've seen it in so many Hyundais. I guess they kind of hit themselves in the foot by giving such a good job in the lower cars, that when you come to a car like the Verna, and if you're upgrading from, say, an Accent, it doesn't feel like the upgrade it should be. It doesn't feel like you're going from a 10 lakh rupee space to something more than that.
Right. Now, with that out of the way, let's quickly move on to everybody's favorite section, the features.
If you're spending close to rupees 15 lakh on a car, it better be equipped with everything under the sun.
These three get the basics spot on. No matter which one you choose, you will get automatic climate control, a front and rear armrest, push button start, a smart key, a rear parking camera, cruise control, and steering mounted audio and telephony controls.
Each of the cars have a few tricks up their sleeves as well. The Yaris brings in segment first, such as front parking sensors, a 4.2 inch colored MID, roof mounted air conditioning, and a 60-40 split second row. But it misses out on 16 inch wheels, it doesn't get a sunroof, a dead pedal, and an auto dimming rear view mirror, all of which the other two get.
Speaking of the Honda City, it packs in exclusives such as all LED lighting, a touch panel for the climate control, an 8-speaker sound system, and reach adjust for the steering. But compared to the Yaris and the Verna, it lacks rear parking sensors and a rear curtain.
Finally, there's the Verna that borrows ventilated seats, a hands-free smart trunk, and projector fog lamps from the Elantra. There's no real missing feature in the Verna per se, except for paddle shifters.
And that makes it the best balance in our books. What nudges things in its favor further are the little details. For instance, all cars here feature a 7-inch touchscreen, but the one on the Verna is the easiest to use, has the best graphics, and features support for Android Auto and Apple CarPlay. Then there are dynamic reverse guidelines and the cornering fog lamps, both of which aren't exactly groundbreaking features, but are definitely nice to have.
If we had to pick one based purely on the way these cars look, we'd run for the keys of the Honda. And that's a bit confounding, isn't it? It's the oldest car here, but that design, it simply refuses to age. It's the head turner of the group for sure. The sharp lines, the dazzling LED headlamps, and that low slung stance do call for attention.
The Verna comes in a close second, but it does look like a generic Hyundai. The flash value has been toned down considerably compared to the version it replaces, and that can go either ways with the prospective buyers. Now, we prefer the grown-up version for sure, with its subdued lines, bigger cascade grille, and those neat 16-inch alloys.
On the other hand, the Yaris just looks a bit staid. The wheels don't sit right with the design, and it appears to be a bit too bulky from the side. It did appeal a whole lot to the oldies in the team though.
Alright, let's quickly wrap things up and figure out which car suits you the most. Now, if you want that buddy gaadi for the family, if you are traveling full house most of the time or all the time, it is the Honda City you should pick. No questions asked. It has the most spacious cabin by miles.
Easily.
And what it also has is a unique X factor. It makes you want it.
It's an emotional connect, isn't it?
It is, because that wow design on the outside and the way the dashboard is laid out, it just makes you want it. But it does miss out. Now, especially when you put these two cars into the mix, the Verna and the Yaris, that iVTEC engine doesn't feel as refined.
Surprisingly.
This is a big surprise. And also, I think it just falls a bit short in delivering that luxury experience.
Precisely, and that's exactly where the Yaris comes into the picture, because what it delivers is finesse. It gives you that luxe car experience by focusing on things that you can't really put down on a brochure. Because the kind of ride quality you have on this, whether it's at high speeds, low speeds, city, highway, bad roads, good roads, it's just exemplary. And then there's the noise insulation. It cuts you out entirely from the outside world. And the drive experience, not only is it incredibly smooth, but it's almost therapeutically calm to drive. But there are still caveats over here. Number one, yes, that beige heavy interior does feel nice and airy, but when you're in the cabin, the knee room, the sense of width, I'm sorry, it is a four-seater at best. And then there's the elephant in the room, and I'm not talking about me or him. It's the price. It's a good 1.5 lakh rupees more than the Verna, and spin it any way you want, that's not an amount that's easy to digest.
Right, because at around 12.5 lakh rupees for the top spec SXO variant, the Verna is defining value for money in this segment. And it isn't the only reason that we're picking the Verna as the winner here, but because of the way a lot of small things come together and make the Verna a very balanced package.
Precisely.
It can be the easy to drive nature, the ride quality, of course, the plethora of features that you have, and it all of that just comes together to give you a very likable car and a very no-nonsense car. Of course, it does have its shortcomings, like the design on the inside, it's just plain boring.
Bit staid.
And yeah, it is staid. And finally, it does not give you that sense of airiness or that sense of, oh, I've upgraded. But that aside, it is the Hyundai Verna that is the most sensible pick of the three.